Hello everyone, in this online lesson, we are going to learn about the small signal models of field effect transistors. Alright, so here's a brief introduction. We know that FETs provide a very good voltage gain. FETs also have a very high input impedance and they consume very little power. And they work over a good range of frequencies. And because FETs have very high input impedance, therefore the gate current, the current into the input terminal is approximated to be is negligibly small, and we can approximate it to be zero. So therefore the current gain for FETs is undefined because we do not have any input current. Okay, so let us now begin to construct a small signal model or an AC model for a FET. Now, you very well know that the voltage that you apply to the input of a FET controls the current flowing from the drain to source. So if you apply a time-varying input voltage, an AC voltage, at the input, consequently you will get a time varying output current. So therefore the change in the drain current is related to the change in the gate voltage by a transconductance factor called the GM. So the formula of GM is then therefore the formula for GM is then the change in the drain current divided by the change of the gate voltage. So how do we determine the transconductance factor GM? Well, there are two ways. The first way is by using graphical method, and the second way is using the mathematical method. So let's first have a look at the graphical method of determining your GM. Well, if you look at your transfer curve, and this is the transfer curve of a JFET or a DMOSFET. So if you look at the transfer curve, the transconductance factor is simply just the slope of the transfer curve at the Q point. So let's say if your Q point is right over here, so the transconductance factor GM is just simply the slope at the Q point, which is just basically you just take a small change of ID and divide it by a small change of VGS. And because we are talking about slope, you will also notice that the slope along the curve varies. You can see that the slope is maximum at the point where your applied gate voltage is zero, and the slope is minimum at the point when your applied gate voltage is equal to the pinch off voltage. And this is not surprising if you understand the mechanism, the operating mechanism of a JFET or a DMOSFET, because when you don't apply any gate voltage, the channel is not impeded and you get a maximum drain current, IDSS. So therefore your conductance factor is maximum. But if you apply your gate voltage is equal to the pinch off voltage, your drain current drops to zero because the channel is impeded by the depletion region which blocks off the channel. So therefore you don't get any drain current, and therefore your transconductance factor GM is zero. Now let us look at the mathematical definition of GM, the transconductance factor, and we can start off with the Shockley's equation, which is the equation that gives you the relationship between the drain current and the applied gate voltage. So GM can be formulated, can be derived by taking the derivative of drain current with respect to VGS in the Shockley equation. So this is our Shockley equation, and you do a derivation of ID with respect to VGS, and you end up with this mathematical definition of GM. So GM is just a function of GMO. GMO is the maximum conductance factor, and also a function of applied gate voltage and VP. And another definition of that is just also a GMO, and you take the ratio of ID of over IDSS and you take the square root of that. And the maximum transconductance factor GMO is defined by this equation here. is sorry, is this equation here is 2i dSS divided by the maximum, the absolute magnitude of pinch off voltage. So this is the mathematical definition of the transconductance factor GM. Let us now examine the impedance parameters of a FET before we fully complete our AC model. So the input impedance of a FET is very, very big, and we can usually approximate it to be an open circuit. So therefore, the input impedance of a FET is infinity. And the reason for this is because there is no electrical connection between the gate terminal and the channel underneath the gate. And the reason for this is that because FETs, field effect transistors, works by the mechanism of field effect. It is the electrical field, it is the gate voltage that you apply at the gate, which changes, which changes the conductance of the channel underneath it. So it's not the current, it's not the current that you apply at the gate terminal. It is the gate voltage, it is the electrical field at, that you apply at the gate terminal, which changes the characteristics of the channel underneath the gate, and therefore controls the magnitude of the drain current. So therefore, input impedance of a FET is infinity. And for the output impedance, can be determined by looking at the output characteristics of the FET. And in this graph here, we have the drain current, the output current ID versus VDS, the output voltage. And so the output impedance can be determined at the Q point by taking the inverse of the derivative of this graph. So, and at this point, looking at this graph, we can see that the output impedance, or small RD for FETs, is also very big. And you can see this by looking at the slope here. In fact, you can also feel it right here, because when you apply a very, very big magnitude of VDS, you can see that the drain current only increases very little, very minimally. So that tells you that the output impedance of the FET is relatively big. So the output impedance RD is just the VDS, change in VDS divided by the change of ID, drain current, at a constant gate voltage. Okay, so having determined all the required parameters, we are now ready to construct our AC model of a JFET. So the model is given here. It is quite a simple one. On the input side, you have the gate source terminal, and because of the input impedance of a JFET is very big, so therefore that is the reason why we have an open circuit here. So essentially, we don't have any gate current because of the open circuit here. And because that tells you that the input impedance is very high, it's infinity. But it is the gate voltage, we do have a gate voltage, VGS voltage, and it is this gate voltage, VGS, that determines the magnitude of the drain current. Alright, so on the output side, we have the drain terminal here and the source terminal here, and current flows from the drain to the source. Current flows from the drain to the source, and we model the magnitude of the drain current by this voltage-controlled current source. This is a voltage-controlled current source. The magnitude of the current is given by GM and VGS. GM is our transconductance factor. VGS is the magnitude of the gate voltage. And that gives you the magnitude of the drain current, and the drain current flows from the drain to the source, as indicated by the arrow here. And also we have an output impedance of the JFET, the RD, and that impedance is over here. Okay, so let us now attach the AC model which we have developed with some biasing circuit. So our first example is fixed bias JFET, common source JFET. Alright, so the source is at the ground. So therefore, it is a common source, and this is our circuit here. Alright, so we have a JFET and with a fixed bias circuit. So in order to do AC analysis, we need to short circuit all the capacitors. So we have two capacitors here, C1 and C2, at the input side and the output side. And we need to turn off all the DC voltage. So all the DC voltage becomes zero, it is connected to ground. So we do that transformation. And from the left figure, we transform it to the right figure, and on the right figure, we see that the capacitors are no longer there. It is being short-circuited. The input voltage is directly connected now to the gate resistor, and the gate resistor is now connected directly to the ground. And the reason is because we have turned off the DC voltage over here. So the gate resistor is now connected directly to the ground. And on the transistor itself, on the JFET, we have the drain current flowing from drain to the source. And on the output side, we have the output taken over the RD. And we can see it from here, actually, the output is connected to the drain resistor and also the drain terminal. So we have that two branches of it over here. One is connected to drain, and one is another branch is connected to the drain resistor. And the drain resistor is now connected directly to the ground because we have turned off the VDD for our AC analysis. So this is how it looks like for an AC analysis for a fixed bias JFET common source. Okay, so what we have here is a common source JFET with a fixed bias configuration. So looking at the diagram and looking from the input side, we know that the input impedance Zin is just equal to RG, the gate resistor. And looking from the output terminal with the Vin off, because we want to determine the output impedance. So with the Vin, Vi set to 0, and determining the output impedance, Z out is simply just your drain resistor RD in parallel with your drain resistor, the small AC resistance RD. So Z out is just your big RD in parallel with your small RD. But if your RD, your small RD, your AC resistance of the drain is bigger than 10 times of your drain resistor, then you can usually approximate your output impedance to be just your RD, your drain resistor, your big RD. And for the voltage gain, you can easily derive this equation by doing a KVL across the output voltage, for the output voltage, and also doing another KVL on the input voltage. And if you take a ratio of that, if you take a ratio of V out over V in, you will end up with this equation here for the voltage gain, because voltage gain is V out over V in, so it's just minus GM multiply with RD parallel with the big RD. But if your RD, your drain AC drain resistance is very, very big, you can just approximate the voltage gain to be minus GM times your drain resistor. And do note that the voltage gain has a minus term in the formula. So that means the output voltage is out of phase with the input voltage. The output waveform is out of phase by 180 degrees with the input waveform by 180 degrees. Okay, so for your own revision, please study example 7, page 505 of our textbook. It is an example of a JFET common source with fixed bias configuration. Okay, so let us now look at the JFET with self-bias configuration. So the circuit is given here. So because it is a self-bias configuration, you don't have a DC voltage connected to the gate, but you do have a source resistor connected to the source terminal. But that source resistor will be bypassed by the capacitor in the AC mode. So we repeat the same step. We turn off we short circuit all the capacitors, and we turn off all the DC voltages in order to prepare our AC model. So doing that into our circuit on the left will give you the circuit on your right. And as you can see, the source resistor, the RS, is no longer in the model because that source resistor is being short-circuited by the source capacitor CS. So that is the reason why it is called a bypass RS configuration, a bypass source resistor, because the RS is being bypassed in the AC mode. So having done that, we are left with this model here of a JFET common source with self-bias configuration. So looking at the input side, you will get the input impedance just equal to gate resistor RG, and the output impedance is equal to the big RD, the drain resistance in parallel with the AC resistance of the drain. So RD in parallel with small RD. But if RD is very, very big, much bigger than 10 times of your drain resistor, then the output impedance can just be approximated to be your RD, your big RD, your drain resistor. And the voltage gain, again, to derive this formula of voltage gain, you just do a KVL around the output terminal, and also you do a KVL around the input terminal, and you take a ratio of that, and you will get this formula for the voltage gain for self-bias configuration JFET. The formula is minus Gm RD, small RD in parallel with big RD. But if RD is very, very big, so if small RD is very, very big, so this small RD becomes open circuit. So your gate voltage gain is just minus Gm times your drain resistance. And again, do note that of the negative polarity here, that means that your output waveform, output voltage is 180 degrees out of phase with the input voltage. Now in this next configuration, we have a self-bias configuration but with an unbypassed source resistor. So we have a source resistor but there is no capacitor connected in parallel with the source resistor. So therefore the RS, the source resistor, is unbypassed. So if we do the transformation of this circuit into an AC model, we get this diagram here, and as you can see, the source resistor RS is still there because it is not bypassed by any capacitor. Okay, so having the AC equivalent circuit, we can now determine the input and output impedance and also the voltage gain. So looking at the input side, your input impedance is just your gate resistance RG, so that's given here, and looking from the output side, your output impedance with your V in off, when your V in it is off, so this guy here, this current source here, becomes an open circuit. So your output impedance is just your RD, your drain resistance. Alright, so that's output resistance. And the voltage gain, the formula for voltage gain is a little bit complicated, mainly because of the presence of the unbypassed source resistor here. So the derivation is in your textbook if you are interested. But the key point here is that also the voltage gain for this self-bias configuration with unbypassed source resistor is still in the negative. It still has a negative polarity on it. So the reason is because your voltage, that tells you that the output voltage output is 180 degrees out of phase with the input voltage. Okay, so please have a look at this example, example 8, page 510 from your textbook. It is on JFET common source with self-bias configuration. Alright, so this is a circuit which you should already be familiar with. It's a JFET common source with a voltage divider bias. So the circuit is given here. So you have a voltage divider bias characterized by this R1 and R2. And it is R1 and R2 which determines the magnitude of your gate voltage. And so in order to analyze this circuit in the AC domain, so you short circuit all the capacitors. So you have three capacitors here on the input and the output and on the RS. So that tells you that the source resistor is bypassed in the AC mode. And also you turn off all the DC voltage. So as a result of applying that steps, you get this diagram over here on your right. So doing that transformation, you will find that R1 and R2 are in parallel. They are connected in parallel, and on the output side, things should look familiar. You have current coming from the drain going to the source, and the source is at the ground. And the magnitude of that drain current is controlled by VGS and transconductance factor GM. And you have your drain resistor connected from the drain terminal towards the ground, and also you have the small AC resistance, AC drain resistance, the small RD. So looking at the AC equivalent circuit of the voltage divider bias configuration of the JFET, so looking at the input side, you know that the input impedance is just equal to R1 in parallel with R2. And on the output side, If the small RU, if the AC resistance of the drain is very, very big, so this guy, the small resistance can be approximated to be an open circuit. So your output impedance, looking for the output with the V in turn off, is just your drain resistance RD, or big RD here. So output impedance is equal to big RD. And the voltage gain is given by this formula here. It's minus GM multiplied by your drain resistance. So again, note that the polarity here is in the negative, so your voltage output and input voltage are out of phase with each other by 180 degrees. So the next configuration that we're going to study is the JFET source follower configuration. Right, so the input is on the gate, the input is always on the gate, but the output is taken off the source terminal over the source resistor RS here. Okay, and the drain is directly connected to the DC voltage VDD. So if we do a transformation of this circuit, we short circuit all the capacitors and we turn off all the DC voltage, we are going to end up with this AC equivalent circuit over here. So the Vin is connected directly to the gate, and also we have a gate resistor connected to the ground. And on the output side, we have the current, we have the drain, which is now on the ground side. Because we turn off the VDD, so it is now a ground. We have the drain current flowing from the ground to the source terminal, right? And the magnitude of this drain current is given by GM times VGS, right? And also we have the source resistor connected to the source. The source resistor is connected to the source and also to the ground. So we have the same effect here. Okay, so looking at the AC equivalent circuit of the source follower JFET, so looking at the input side, the input impedance is just equal to your gate resistance RG, and on the output side, the output impedance is equal to your source resistance RS in parallel with your AC drain resistance RD in parallel with the inverse of your transconductance factor GM, right? And the voltage gain is given by this formula here, and also note that the polarity of the voltage gain is positive, meaning that the output and input are in phase with each other. Okay, so please study this example 10 from page 518 of your textbook. It's an example of a JFET with common drain configuration. Okay, so far we have been using JFETs as our examples. So what about DMOSFETs? What about how does an AC equivalent model, how does an AC model of a DMOSFET looks like? So if you recall that the DMOSFETs operate in pretty much similar ways to a JFET, except that DMOSFETs can be operated with positive gate voltages. So that's the only difference. Other than that, it's pretty much the same. The drain current, the current of a DMOSFET is still governed by the Shockley's equation. So therefore, DMOSFETs have similar AC models to those of JFETs, right? And that's about it. The only difference is that the gate voltage VGS can be positive for N-channel DMOSFETs and negative for P-channel devices. So that means the transconductance factor of a DMOSFET can be greater than the GMO, and GMO is the maximum transconductance factor. Alright, so the AC model of a DMOSFET looks very similar to, in fact, it is similar to a JFET. You have the GS terminal over here, and the open circuit is still there because of the high input impedance. So you don't have any gate current, but you have a gate voltage, and that gate voltage determines the magnitude of the drain current, and that is symbolized by the current voltage control current source over here. So the direction of the current tells you that the current flows from the drain to the source, and the magnitude of the drain current is given by GM times VGS. And also there's still the AC resistance of the drain connected between the drain and the source. Okay, so because DMOSFET's AC equivalent model is pretty much similar to those of JFETs, you can study them on your own. You can study this example 11 from page 519 on the AC equivalent model of D-MOSFETs. This example is from your textbook. Now, what about the E-MOSFETs or the enhancement mode MOSFETs, as enhancement MOSFETs? Now, you already know that the drain current of an E-MOSFET of the enhancement MOSFET is not governed by the Shockley's equation, but rather it is given by this equation here. So ID for E-MOSFET is a function of the parameter K, the applied gate voltage, and the threshold voltage. So if you take a derivative of ID over VGS, you can come up with the transconductance factor for E-MOSFET. So if you do that, you get that the formula of transconductance factor GM is equal to 2K multiplied by VGS minus VT. So this is the formula for GM, for E-MOSFET. And you can readily fit that into the existing model that we have for AC model that we have for a GFET, because it looks pretty much similar. And on the input side, you have the open circuit between the gate and the source and the gate and the drain, because of the high input impedance. So you don't have any gate current coming into, but you do have a gate voltage VGS, and it is this VGS that gives you the magnitude of the drain current. And the drain current still flows from the drain to the source as directed by the arrow of the voltage controlled current source here. And the magnitude of the drain current is given by GM times VGS, and we also have the AC drain resistance connected between the drain and the source terminal. So now we have an E-MOSFET with a voltage divider bias configuration. You have R1 and R2, and you have the a bypassed source resistor connected to the source. So if you turn off, if you want to prepare this for an AC analysis, you turn off all the DC voltages and you short circuit all the capacitors, you end up with your figure on your right here. You have your R1 and R2 in parallel, and the drain current is given by GM times VGS, and the direction tells you that the drain current comes from the drain to the ground to the source, and the source is connected to the ground. And you have the drain resistor RD also connected between the drain to the source, so the drain to the drain to the ground. And also, because we have a capacitor CS here, C capacitor connected at the source, and that capacitor bypasses the source resistor, so therefore we don't see the source resistor in the AC analysis because it is being bypassed, it is being short-circuited by the capacitor. So looking at the voltage divider bias configuration of the E-MOSFET, it looks pretty much similar to what to those of a JFET. On the input side, the input impedance is just equal to your R1 in parallel with R2, so that is given here. And on the output side, the output impedance can be approximated to be just equal to your source resistance, the resistance of your source resistor RD. And the voltage gain is given by this formula here, minus GM times RD, source resistor. So again, do note that the voltage gain is in the minus, it has a minus polarity there. And finally, let's have a look at the drain feedback configuration for the E-MOSFET. So in this configuration, you have a feedback resistor connecting the gate and the drain terminals together. So if you do the transformation, you short circuit all the capacitors and turn on the DC, you have this model over here. You have your RF feedback resistor connecting your gate terminal to your drain terminal. Okay, so these are the formulas for the input and output impedances of the drain feedback configuration for E-MOSFET, as well as the formulas for the voltage gain. The formulas look a little bit more complicated merely just because of the presence of the feedback resistor, but really they can all be derived. If you're interested, you can look at the textbook. You can read it up on the textbook on the derivations. It's basically just doing a KCL and KVL on the input and the output side and defining the currents and voltages along the way, and you get the formulas stated here. So please study example 12 from page 523 of your textbook, it is on the drain feedback configuration for your E-MOSFET. Okay, so finally, these are some of the practical applications of the MOSFET as an AC amplifiers that we have learned so far. So it's quite an interesting read. So I would suggest that you read these examples up from your textbook. The one that I want to briefly discuss about is this practical application of a MOSFET as in a motion detection system. Right, so you have a MOSFET here in the middle, and on the input side you have a heat sensor. It's an infrared sensor. So what this sensor does is that it detects heat signatures from infrared rays. Right, so the variation of the heat that it receives gives it, and the output of that variation, the output of the heat that it receives, results in a variation of gate voltage that is being applied at the gate terminal. So you get an AC, a time varying AC signal being fed into the gate terminal of the MOSFET, coming out from the infrared, from the heat sensor. And this is because as you move closer and closer towards the sensor, you will give off more and more heat towards the sensor, and this change and this signature changes over time. It is varying with presumably low frequency. So on the input side you have a low frequency AC signal, AC voltage being fed into the gate, and on the output side you have a first stage amplifier. It amplifies the low frequency component of the input signal. And the output of that is being fed into a comparator network, and I presume that in this network there's a processor which compares the peak values or the components or the frequencies or the magnitudes of the output against the predetermined values, and that processor will decide whether or not to turn on the light or the alarm or any other control system. So that's basically how a motion detection system works, by using a FET amplifier with time varying signal applied into the gate of the, into the input of the MOSFET. Alright, so with that I conclude our online lesson for this chapter. So for those of you who are enrolled into the course that I teach, KL2174 Analog Electronics, please solve these problems at the back of chapter 8. There are 7 questions that I want you to solve, and I will state the deadline later in our Facebook group. Alright, so thank you for watching. I'll see you again soon.